Hey everybody, nice to be here with you today. Mike Fairbourn, sitting in for Mr. James Boyd. James will be in next week, but I'm really looking forward to our discussion today, folks, using options as a stock investor. Now, specifically, I want to talk today about finding those support levels out there. Some of those are not always too obvious. I want to talk about you really utilizing a scientific method to do that and really to position a bullish to neutral type trade around them. So I look forward to going through that with you. By the way, it is great to see some of the old familiar names in the chat. Good to have you all on board today. We do have Mr. Brent Moores in the chat helping out. Brent is just a great, incredible resource, very knowledgeable instructor. I encourage you to take a look at Brent's classes as well. But folks, any questions, comments you might have, throw those into the chat box. Also, any topic requests as well, definitely post those so I could pass those along to JB, who is taking some well-needed time off. By the way, you can follow Brent and I on X. There's our handles right there. All right. Thank you very much for that, Brent. Hey, let's dive into our disclosures to get started here. Get the show on the road, folks. So first up, options do carry a high level of risk. They're not suitable for all investors. Please keep that point in mind as well as other points listed here specifically on this first bullet point. In addition, the information here is for general information purposes only. It should not be considered an individualized recommendation. Okay, some additional points. The paperMoney software application is for educational purposes only as well. Investing does involve risk, including the loss of principal. In addition to that, past performance of any security strategy does not guarantee future results or success. Now, short options, they can be assigned at any time up to expiration, regardless of the in-the-money amount. Okay, an ITM option does have a higher risk of being assigned early. Please keep that in mind as we go through this. And I think we're looking good on that. So those are our disclosures. Be mindful of those, folks. Turning to our agenda here. Now, this particular agenda slide does cover assessing market conditions. So we'll take some time to take a look at just general market conditions, not spending a lot of time, but just a brief overview of the market. We want to discuss specific strategies potentially to enhance protected portfolio. Today, I wanted to talk to you today about, you know, just some of the moves that we've seen in the market. This just the general strength that we've had. You know, some markets may have been potentially overvalued to a degree. Some industries. And so getting that neutral aspect in there, I think can be very, very helpful. I want to kind of explore that today a bit more, along with some of those interesting, potentially interesting support levels through specifically weekly Fibonacci levels and tying that in with the chart as we look at, short put verticals. Okay. Specifically, ways to, you know, incorporate that neutral side of things. And we'll definitely talk about some examples here as we go through this. But having said that, let's dive in first now, or next, I should say, into the markets here as we look at the markets. And you can see that we're just continuing higher here, but maybe a little bit of a pause after a fairly large move within the market. A number of these just very, very small mini flag patterns, which are not too uncommon to see after such a rally in the market. We're coming to that point where we're just kind of hitting kind of off the top here as well. I'm going to zoom into that here just so you can kind of point that out a little bit. But you can see we're just kind of going sideways here over this time frame. Will we have another rally? Can we move higher? Right now, you know, the markets are down. You can't see the YM actually up right now, continuing to make higher highs and higher lows. Now, the RT, the NQ, very, very similar to the ES. We had just gotten smaller and smaller flag patterns to the point that the move to the upside is almost flat relative to, you know, just where it had been previously. We started off with some bigger moves. And so sometimes you can flatten out, move higher, or begin to pull back. Of course, yeah, well, you can always go sideways too, right? A quick note here, the Russell, a little bit different. RTY, you can see we've been holding down for a little bit of some period of time, kind of in a flat range. Many of the companies within the Russell, obviously domestic companies, you don't find very many at all international companies within the Russell. And the U.S. has been hammered, you know, by inflationary pressure, you know, to a few, one degree or another. These companies have felt a lot of that and not as poised within the market in terms of revenue streams, et cetera, that you might find with the larger even some of the mid-cap companies and some of these other markets up top. So just kind of a brief overview there. Now, I'm going to just take some time and dive right into our discussion now. I want to start off with, actually, yeah, we'll look at Starbucks. We'll look at several, actually, companies here. I've thrown out here a Fibonacci level. This is a weekly chart. This is a three-year weekly. And what I've done is I've simply drawn off the bottoms and the tops here and highlighted here for you these interesting levels, these percentages, if you haven't used them before. Now, the reason why I have tapped into Fibonacci on a weekly scale is because sometimes when you're looking at a daily chart, you know, these lower levels down here, they don't look as obvious to a degree. In other words, we've seen a number of different bounces coming off these points, right? We've seen levels here, here, through here, here again. Of course, we consolidated through here. Really kind of bouncing around a range, really kind of between 92, excuse me, I'd say 91 and 90 range. So somewhere in here, a number of touch points. Now we can see the confirmation of those touch points just by looking at the daily chart here, but a weekly chart can help us to see this a little bit better, particularly if there is a defined line drawn through there at that point in time. And I'm going to talk about Fibonacci's here in just a second, but just to highlight this line, notice what we have here, a fairly strong upward move and a consolidation that's lasted actually since last, you know, it's supposed to be a straight line, about September-ish, we've been bouncing around a little bit, September of last year. Now we've run up to a few additional points on the upside, and we've held at also, notice, when you put it into a weekly format, you can really start to see, wow, you know, these are some interesting levels. I mean, the last highs that we hit too, right around this additional level at 38.2 Fibonacci. Okay, so what, first of all, are these Fibonacci levels? What do they mean? What are these numbers? Well, it's really kind of a scientific approach that we're following. And if you follow me down here, by the way, in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen, this is where the drawing tools are right here. And so I'm just going to click on the drawing tool. Many of you have seen these before drawn. We've got the retracements. And just to the right of that, of course, we have the extensions. Now, these are percentages that are found within nature. And there are a lot of different aspects of these percentages that you'll find. I mean, for example, a tree branch, as it branches off, it will frequently branch off at a 50% or a 61.8% level. You'll find all kinds of sea life that have the same things, like a nautilus mollusk. It extends out at a 61.8% retracement level. And so too does the Milky Way galaxy that we all live in. So too does the human body. If you start at the middle and you go, you know, if you extend it out, it will hit like at a 61.8% retracement level. These are the different Fibonacci points that you'll find. And because the market is really a collection of a number of individuals through nature, each of us, sometimes you'll find these points occurring. Now, the key point, though, is, you know, as you spot these levels, do you see prices actually responding to each of these levels? I'll go full screen here just to kind of highlight this. But are they a key word that a lot of technicians will use? Or do they anchor to prior levels on the chart? Are there a number of touch points? The weekly levels are interesting because it doesn't really define a specific level in time. It would just be like, you know, and the number of touch points along here. A lot of traders, even on a short-term basis, will look for trades that do something like this, using stocks here as the underlying, right? They'll look for a move to come down below the 50, and then they'll wait for prices to tick right above the 50 for an entry point. That is the signal that some traders will use, okay? And what they'll do is they'll trade this to the next Fibonacci level or levels. We broke through very sharply on that bar. We came to this upper level where we kind of paused, where there were other touch points, right? Prior highs. The point is that we have prior levels here, but they're falling in very nicely to some of these Fibonacci points, okay? Now, as I say all these things, what do you see within this pattern? There is a larger pattern here at play too. That is a strong move to the upside and a more mild move to the downside. You could categorize this, I think some might, as a weekly sort of a flag pattern. A lot of times technicians like us to hold it around the 50% level regardless. They want to hold it 50. So in other words, if I've made a run from this point, I want to pull back around 50%, but maybe not too much lower. The very bottom level they might look for is a 61.8 for a bounce. And a lot, not everyone obviously, but a lot of weekly charts, if you look at them, they'll come right down to the 61.8. And that's where they'll pause. And some traders too, what they'll do is they will look at a trade that comes just like this anyways. It'll come below the 61.8. And as soon as it breaks back up above that level, that is where they get interested in terms of, okay, well, maybe the whole pattern now is beginning to follow through, right? And that's what they could be looking at. So just think about that for just a moment. We have the fibs. I'm going to go ahead and click on them right now just so you've got them. But bottom right-hand corner, that's where I found these. Now, how do you set these up? I just want to quickly tell everybody because, I mean, yeah, you can see zeros and 100s, et cetera. But you're dragging, if you're measuring a range where there's a pullback from the top down, you start at the high and pull it back down. And that's why that we've got a zero up top here. Oh, I'm sorry. The 100% range right there off the bottom, we're pulling it up to the top. Okay, so measuring the range, if it's from a range on a pullback, you measure from the low to the high. If it's just the opposite, for example, over here, this high level, we start at the top and then pull down, and that will give us the appropriate Fibonacci levels on that end as well. Okay, so that is how that works. Right now, though, we're looking for the possibility of a potential recovery here on this stock, taking it off those lows. So what I wanted to do was draw your attention to this point as we zoom back into our daily chart right now. So looking at this, we're kind of flirting around that 50% level right now. We're going to look at it today as if we may continue to hold this point and at least consolidate around this level. So like we saw within the markets, many of those markets may have been a little bit, they've run a course, right? And we've even seen some of this within the market, a little bit of a sideways action. So some markets may have been a little bit overvalued, possibly, right? And we might see a pullback. So we want to look at an aspect where there's that neutral element as well, because even though, the S&P 500 has run up quite a bit, if we were to get a move down, and I'm sure many of you have seen this before, but if the SPX does take a dip to the downside here, what do you think could happen with even like a company like Starbucks that hasn't participated a lot? Well, if it's a market pullback, it could dip as well. But possibly we've been holding at this level for quite some time. Maybe there's a sideways consolidation too, right? Maybe it can hold up sideways. So what I want to talk today about was we're selling those put contracts and staying basically neutral to bullish along that level, really where we've been since September of last year. We've really kind of been bouncing around. There has been a tendency for this company to do a couple of things. It's either kind of consolidated along that level or bounced ultimately along that level. Consolidated or bounced. Here we are again. We're down through this level. There could be a consolidation. But what trade using options as a stock investor could we profit as prices maybe go sideways or up? And could we, based upon what we're seeing here in that long-term Fibonacci, maybe look at a position where something we could do month to month to month into the future, possibly? I mean, is what a trader, just playing the role of a trader, maybe that's something they might be looking at on an individual trade. So let's do that. Let's go ahead and take a look at what a strategy like that would look like. So first of all, if we were selling a 90 put right there, and if we had been doing that really since September of last year at different timeframes, it wouldn't have helped us too much at these levels. But down through here, I mean, this is a weekly chart. So these are, months that have passed by in here. It could have worked for us along this long-term 50% Fibonacci level. Okay. Now, with that, if we were to also work on another approach, and that is adding a long-term put to this, that could also be of interest to some traders, right? So let's do this. If we were to sell a 90 put right there at 90, prices do hold, basically, if they can stay flat, 90 is just slightly below that level, but you know, a move to the upside, sideways, or even slightly down, a trader would look at that as being potentially a way to generate income from the markets. Okay, I'm going to pull that up right now so we can kind of explore that just a little bit under the trade tab. Right now we have, I'm looking at the 31 days out in time. Now we have implied volatility over here. It's not too bad. Well, we're getting close to 20, you know, in the 20s, almost 22 here. We have a lot of volume, or I should say open interest here. The stock has volume about, you know, a little over a million. And these are one of the key points that a trader would want to look at is really volume, you know, strong volume as well. So you can keep the bid and ask prices tighter here, right? We're looking at a 34 delta. Now, what is the delta measure? Well, for a $1 change in the underlying stock to the upside, if the stock goes up, the delta would tell us what the amount of the option would go to the downside. And we are on the put side, obviously, and so that's a negative. A move to the upside could be a positive for us. Here we are around 50%, that 50% level. If we move up, that could only stand to help out this option contract. It has 31 days left. Really 20 to 50 is where a lot of traders will look for those trades. Some go out further in time, no doubt about it. In fact, we could certainly look at that too, because there, you know, some traders might say, well, there's sort of a bit of a tendency for prices to hold flat for a period of time. Why not go out in another month? And that could be looked at too. In fact, I'll pull it up right now just to kind of compare the two. Actually, let's do this. I'm going to narrow this down. Let's go to 8. These side-by-side comparisons are really quite helpful. I'm actually going to go out to the June quite a ways out just to kind of show you what we're going to get there for that additional time. Now, that's quite a bit more time. That's 94 days, as you can see over here. What impact does that have? If somebody was, let's just say, you know, well, substantially more, you know, more bullish, or they just had more confidence in the price of the stock really holding up above that 90 level, that's, you know, significantly more than we're getting in terms of our bid here. What, $1.16 to $3.25. Deltas don't move too much there, but 35 to 40. So think about the movement of the underlying stock. If the stock were to go higher, this option down here would erode. It would drop just based upon our delta slightly quicker, right? For a dollar move to the upside. So it does have a larger premium, and that would be reduced further. By the way, over here on the theta end, too, we're looking at 3 cents versus 2 cents. The theta is a lot slower. The time decay, that is, and that is, of course, 7 days a week that we're getting there. So just making some comparisons along a couple of these option Greeks, as you can see, by the way, down here too. So plenty of volume still, even going out to the June contract at this point in time. I'm going to start off first. I mean, we can look at those further out in time, but what I wanted to do was pull up the 90 right now for the 35 days. So the April, the next month out, basically, is what we're looking at here. Okay, so a couple of things here. So we're looking at $1.16. If the price of the stock were to go below that 90 and really close below that 90 by expiration, we're still on the weekly chart here, but if it were to go below that level by expiration in April, sometime over here, there's a very high likelihood that that would be assigned to us. So on a standard equity options contract, for every put contract we're selling, be equivalent to 100 shares of stock. The good news is we still get to keep our premium, the option premium. So that $1.16 less commission, we would still get to keep that, and that could lower our cost basis if somebody wanted to hold on to it. Now that's the concern. If it starts to break this longer term fib, I mean, it's all the way down to 86 roughly for the 61.8 level. 61.8, that's kind of hidden there. 61.8 right there. Okay. There you go. So, because we are on a weekly chart, there can be a distance between the two. All right. But again, like we said, though, what we've seen here is traders may be expecting prices to hold a little bit higher, sideways, or even down to a degree, holding above the 90. We're about a dollar and a half above that level right now. So maybe a little bit of wiggle room, but they might be anticipating that just to collect the income. Let's explore that right now on this trade. I'm going to go over here and take a look at it. It's moved up to $1.17. Let's look at the order here. A key point is the max loss. It is almost $9,000, and that's if Starbucks were to go, we were to get assigned stock, and the shares were to go to, let's say, for example, zero. If the stock does go to zero, well, we own stock, right? Let's say we're assuming that assignment occurs, and that would be a max loss situation. Your credit is just the premium received, less any commissions, and then there is your margin requirement right there. Now, it's not like really a cheap stock. Obviously, it's cheap compared to a lot of others out there, but having said all that, what I will say is that there may be some ways too, just to cheapen that, maybe take some off the table, and let me go back up to our, here we are, back to our, what about the 85? What if we bought the 85? So turning it into a short put vertical trade right there. Now our credit is only 89 cents. Let's take a look and see what that does to the max loss and to the buying power effect. You can see the impact that it has there, right? The max loss is only 411 now relative to almost 9,000. The buying power effect, the margin requirement substantially less. Now the credit is less as well. It's not a lot less, but it is less, no question about it. By buying the additional leg down here at 85, it can do a couple of things. Why is that max loss so different? Well, if prices were to suddenly really break lower here, we're only going to lose during the contract time to 85, and we saw what our max loss was on this trade. Now that's different if we just had a short put by itself, because obviously prices could fall and that could be a dramatic decline, right? It could be huge. I mean, well, we're going to be looking at it on a dollar for dollar decline from 100 shares on down. And we saw what that max loss looked like, which was basically our stock ownership of 100 shares less the option premium all the way down to the possibility of zero. Now, very low expectations for that to occur. But, you know, these dips happen all the time in the market. You guys remember this trade or this stock not too long ago, Palo Alto Networks. Yeah, a big move like this, you'll see it on the daily chart. That was around earnings. But let's say, for example, a short put vertical would have, if somebody was bullish to neutral, depending upon where that long leg was, it would have held, in other words, you would not have participated in the downside move. Right. So that's the other aspect. And that's why those numbers are so different, is because it's not, you know, calculating that in that massive drop all the way down to the possibility of dropping all the way down to zero or even a $10 or $20 dip. That's what you're getting with this level. Now, one thing that traders can do, what we were getting about $1.16, they might look at it this way. They say, well, hey, you know, here's your credit. You got a credit there of 89 cents, less than $1.16 or $116. What if we were to just adjust this to a couple of contracts, right? What does this look like? So we're still way off from the max loss of just the short put by itself, 822. So our numbers increased, they doubled here. So too did our buying power effect. But now we're more than the 116, right? In terms of the total credit received, the potential gain on this through expiration. So this is increased, it's higher, this is still lower, and this is still lower just by adding that additional leg in. Now, obviously, this does depend upon, hey, how do you feel about the max loss? Obviously, that's a key point, the trade in general. Does that fit with what I'm after? And do I really want to take these max losses in case it does start to work against me as well? If prices break down a little bit, could I take it off the table? Do I have to shoot for the whole 178? A lot of things to consider here. A lot of traders might just look for a portion of this as well to trade. Okay. But I'm going to go ahead and submit this one for you or for us, just as in the paper money account right now. Okay, so that is the trade. And basically, you know, this is a way to, like I said, help to kind of give you a buffer in case there is a lot of excess volatility in the market. We're not really on a stock that's had that high, and we're trying to combine that really with maybe a long-term support level that has been shown, at least to this point in time, to hold up fairly well with that long-term Fibonacci point at the 50. Remember, so everything's kind of based upon that, and we're seeing if that can help play a key role in really keeping us above this level, right, or near that level. And like I said, if it were to move up higher, that would be another consideration too. That could further and quickly reduce the value of our option, making the trade, more profitable quicker. It's all based on this. And so I wanted to really kind of keep utilizing this a little bit more, but then tapping into the short put vertical as a way to, I don't know, maybe offset certain market conditions that traders might be seeing out there. All right. Now, I'm going to scroll on down and see if there are any questions. Oh, Brent's nailed a lot of these for us. Thank you. All right. Thank you. And very good, folks. By the way, encourage everybody, bottom right-hand corner of the screen, just smash that subscribe button if you're new, you haven't subscribed already. And we do have some subscribers here, I know, just looking at a few of you, BJ, others, Jody, you know, you've been here for quite some time, and it is nice to, you've subscribed, but so if you haven't seen it, you can always really subscribe one time, but love to have you on board. You pick up a lot of great stuff that Brent's got, other coaches as well. So encourage you to do that. Now, what other questions? I think Brent's got us all caught up, and this is excellent. Let's see. Gene says, if Starbucks falls, can I buy back the 90 and let the, you absolutely can. Yeah, as long as the option market is open, you can buy and sell those based upon different trades. Now, if you wanted to let the 85 ride, exactly. So say, for example, it did break lower and you wanted to just close out the short leg and let the long leg continue, which could be profitable if prices were to dip, you do that. But you just want to make sure that everything you were looking at there, Gene, would be like totally the opposite of what you thought was going to happen. Right. In other words, and that can happen, right? You can look at a market and you think it's going to be totally different. Yes, you can trade those off for sure. In fact, you know, when prices do break below a given level, it is very important to be mindful of, because we have not done that really since, like I said, September of last year. So another interesting thing to do, just go ahead and right click on the chart. You can put an alert down through here as well. There's your alert, and you've got to change this up top. It's got to be at or below right there. So again, I right-clicked on the chart. I'll show that again. I right-clicked the level where I want to be notified if we do break below that point, because we have dipped below that level. We're on the verge maybe of breaking above the 50%, and we'll see what happens there on the Fibonacci, but it's still just below where we're at, about 89.50. At or below that level, notify me, let me know if that happens. By the way, I'm going to go back to this trade. And I'm going to do is cancel replace. I'm going to put it as a market order just to get it under our belt here. Okay, there we go. In paper money. These are just paper trades here replacing. But there we go. Now, all right. Yes, thank you, Virginia. Awesome. All right, let's do this now. I'm going to go over here. I want to take a look at another company. Here's Cisco. Here is a three-year weekly chart. And a lot of times too, now this is something I've learned over the past, well, this kind of dates me a little bit, but the past couple of decades as I've been trading, is a lot of times, you know, some traders will look at a level that has a lot of, let me zoom in on this so you can see it, a lot of correlation. In other words, there are a lot of touch points here. We got one, two, three, maybe four, if you're counting this closing price, as opposed to just this candle pattern down below. So a lot of times I'll just look at, hey, what's our most common touch point? A lot of times those I think are just better set for trades, for placing these Fibonacci's. I'm going to do the exact same thing. I start at the bottom. I clicked on our Fib, right? I'm going to pull it up here. We're looking at this on a weekly chart, and there you go. Do you see the 50% level? Do you see the level two? Ooh, doesn't show 50. There we go. Does it now? No. Why is that? There we go. I had to widen it out a little bit. Have to adjust that later too, but there you go. There's your 50%. Not too unusual to come down and find if, in fact, you are going to hold. You don't have to, but we did it over here a couple of times, 61, 61, holding near that level and not really making moves too much lower than that point. Here's your 61.8. You break up above here, and here we are again at a higher low. We've been inching up along the Fibonacci scale almost like a staircase. Do you see that? And you'll see this happen sometimes. Right now, we're just above this level. Now, does this tell us that we're going to break up higher and continue on up? No, not necessarily, right? The pattern has shown some strength in here. The company, by the way, did have some inventory issues, and they tried to work through some of those, just looking at the company a little bit and understanding what's going on behind the scenes with the company. But yeah, they're back up above that 50% level, and they're kind of holding that point now too. So we are dealing with a weekly pattern, a weekly chart, the importance of a weekly chart, and seeing, you know, because we want to see more data. And then we also want to see, are there any patterns associated with it as it relates to support operating behind the scenes, and maybe a little bit of a possible staircase here as prices are trending higher. Now, this is really close to the 50 level as well. I should say there's a 50% Fibonacci that I have in blue, but this is also $50 as well, which can be an interesting round number for prices to hold. The whole idea, what I just mentioned, prices to hold, folks, hold. Now, could it continue with the trend? Yes, but it doesn't really matter with the short put or the short put vertical. As long as we're holding above a given strike price, we can be just as profitable with prices trading sideways or slightly down as they are shooting up over the time frame that we're looking at. Which I thought was always so strange, right? What do you mean? I can make the same amount of money? Yeah, you can make the max gain by prices going flat. Now, we've added an element there instead of just the short put. We've looked at the short put vertical tied into it, which we're going to do here on Cisco as well. So let's go into that phase next. We'll just dive right over into the trade tab here. And there's a weekly in here, but that is for something else. That is like a covered call or something I've done in a different class. So what I'm going to do, let's look at these two. We've got the April and we've got the May. 31 days, and we've got 59 days out in time. Okay, so here's our 50. We're below, we're currently below 50. Let's look at initially, let's take a look at the deltas. So really between 20 and 40 is the range right over here, and these are the numbers associated with it. Now, if we really zoom in and we look at that 50% on a daily chart, there it is right there. And this is the same weekly drawing that you've got right here. And we're actually just kind of sitting on it right now. Now, there have been a number of interesting touch points. We gap below it. We gap back up above it. We came very close to touching it through here, here, here. It's been a support level, and here we are again. At this level, we gapped down to it. We jumped right back to it. We held support and ran up. There have been some interesting levels or anchoring around that 50% level. Okay, notice down here with me, where was the last support level? Why not use this? Why not use or look at a 48? That was the lower point. Now, obviously, we've made some higher highs, a higher low at this point in time, and kind of consolidating. But that might be a level that a trader could initially begin to look at, because you've got a couple of different barriers here, possibly. Well, there's the tendency, you're above the 50% fib. Weekly fib right there. You're coming off a higher low. You've got this in place, and now you've got the last lows, and these last lows over here seem to consolidate nicely with this point too, or really consolidated over here. All right, so just some considerations to keep in mind. Let's look at the 48 right now. What is the delta on that 48? How does it compare going out further in time too? All right, so there we go. So there's the 48, it's a 27 delta. Explain what the delta is, but the delta is also a proxy estimate for the percent probability, according to the delta, that we are going to trade below that level by expiration, 27%. So there's only a 27% chance right now as it stands, even though those delta numbers do vary, they change, that we'll go below 48 as it stands right now, according to that number that we're seeing. So do you see how that is also a probability, potentially, that a trader could factor in? We looked at the longer term weekly chart. We looked at the support level at 50. We looked at the potential support level at 48. Right? How is the spread doing? A 2 cent spread? Stock is over a million shares. We don't have a ton of open interest over here, but I believe this is probably an addition. I don't know what's going on because we have a lot at 47.50. Anyways, you got the 48 there as well, and some might choose the 47.50, but there's your 48. Let's go ahead and take a look and see what this shows us, the 48 alone, if we're looking at the bid price with 31 days to expiration. What are we seeing on just the short put by itself? About still, it's getting up close to $5,000 in terms of a max loss. Buying power effect, a little over 1,300. Okay. Well, let's do this. Let's go ahead and look at adding. I'm going to add a couple more strikes. Well, a few more strikes. There we go. 15. There we go. A $2 wide spread on this. So I'm going to go ahead and hold the control button down on the keyboard and click on the ask price right there. And that's obviously going to reduce us to a 30 cent credit, but what does that do in terms of our max loss, et cetera? $170, quite a bit less. The credit's only $30 over this time frame, but substantially lower max loss, and the buying power effect is lower as well. Let's go to edit right now. I'm going to go ahead and just add three of these in to pull this up to a 90 credit, but I want to see what the max loss is at this point in time. It's up to 500 now. We've amped it up basically three times. Okay. Effectively by adding in those additional contracts right there. But that is the trade we're looking at here. Now, I'm not going to put that trade in. I'm going to look at the next month out and do a comparison here, because the expectation might be for us to hold around this level a little bit longer. So let's go out just a month further in time. And what are we doing here? Well, we're adding in some additional time, clearly. We've got 59 days. We're going to take out 31. So we've adding in 28 additional days by going out to our May contract here. Okay. Okay, so there's our 48. 46. We do not have a 48. However, we do have a 47.50, which is a little bit lower. It's a 2 cent spread. Your open interest over here is about 800 in the 800s. Okay, so we've got that. It's fairly tight. We have a 2.5 wide is the best we can do over here. Let's go ahead and explore this and just see what this looks like. So there's your 97 on the bid right there. Okay, it's actually less than our initial contract at 48, right? It's a little bit less. The max loss is lower. The buying power effect, I think, could be slightly lower. Don't quote me on that, but it might have been. Our credit is clearly higher. Notice three contracts. We did three contracts for the April. We're still not up to the level of a single contract here on this short put, exclusively this short put. Okay, let's see if we can just get something even more interesting down here at the 45. I'm going to click on the ask price. So at 2.5 wide, you're getting a 55 cent credit here. Okay, if we were to look at this trade, you've got a 195 max loss, 55 credit. buying power effect is 195. Now, for some people, they might just be fine looking at just exclusively selling the put by itself. Others might want to make sure that, well, maybe there's a little bit of a buffer in there, a range, so that if the prices were to drop dramatically over the time frame they're invested in or they're trading, that they're not subject to that substantial loss of the downside if it were to gap down. Now, you're not going to have earnings. We just had earnings, let's see, in February. Next earnings would be actually, yeah, towards the end of May. So we'd be very, very close to another earnings announcement using that May contract. Just some considerations here around having a fairly big move. Okay. I still want to do the short put vertical. I'm going to add one additional contract here. Pull this up to about 110. Yeah, 110 right here. So there is the max loss. So on this trade, I'm going to go ahead and send that through as we've looked at it. What we've done here is we were able to go out a little bit further in time. The next month out, oops, sorry, let's go right here. We went out the next month. And we said, there is, I'm just going to point to it, roughly 47.50. That puts us below that support level right there. Okay. We did a couple of contracts here. But then also, you know, we were able to dip down to the 45 where we purchased those puts to hold us at that lower point as well. So in other words, if prices were for whatever reason to really dip, well, over the contract period that we've got, you know, we wouldn't be losing below that 45 strike price on the put. So not only did we lower the max loss, we improved, you know, definitely some components of the margin requirement. We were able to do a couple of contracts and lift that premium as well. Again, folks, a lot of this ties into, what are the expectations on a weekly chart? Are you okay with what we've seen the stock do already, utilizing that Fibonacci weekly, really trying to tie into the importance, tap into the importance of those weekly charts? Can it hold that range over that period of time? This stock too, some traders might be looking at it. I mean, it does have a higher, well, it's got a dividend too. Now, of course, when you sell puts, until you actually own shares and own them before the options, X date, you know, for example, you wouldn't get that. But just as a side note, and by the way, as a quick note, dividend paying stocks, of course, they can lose value too. Since I brought it up, I need to bring that point too. Obviously, they can drop just like other stocks can as well. All right. Well, with that, I hope you found this useful and informative, folks. I really do. I think those long-term weekly charts can be effective. They just give you more data. I think it can be a good reference point, and then tapping into maybe a scientific approach for support levels, spotting those can be effective too. So I encourage you to just take the time. It's just as quick as a click. In fact, what I've done over here, just so you know, up top, I've set this up, my grid, just on a two wide. I've got one over here. And of course I could go like this and have them side by side, which is what you'd normally see on this. But for me, it makes it a lot easier to have that to the right and to check those longer term charts, as opposed to going in and pulling up a weekly chart, folks. So encourage you to also set up maybe a grid chart to do this. Could be helpful. By the way, once you've got it set up like this, just go down to maximize sell right there. And then you can pop right back and allows you to go back and forth between the two. Once you have these set up, which you can do right over here in this button, just go down under save grid as, and there you go. There's my daily, weekly. Well, it's pretty well defined. It's a split chart right there. A very quick way to get to that. All right. Well, with that all, it has been nice being here with you on a short notice to step in for Mr. James Boyd. He will be back next week. Folks, if you like this presentation, give us a like there. That just helps the YouTube algorithm to keep this class that James teaches coming up more frequently. And again, subscribe, bottom right-hand corner of the screen. I encourage you to do that. All right. Well, that is what we went through today with you. Folks, hopefully you found this informative and useful. That was the goal as we went through it. But yeah, we did assess market condition. We talked about that. We talked about the short put strategy and adding to that in terms of a short put vertical spread. Placed a couple of trades there to look at as well. And on that note, folks, have a great rest of the day. See you next time.